In the past, predictions about future warfare have often put too much emphasis on new technologies and assumed only one country would have access to them. In the 19th century, the speedy victory of the Prussian army over France convinced European powers that rapid mobilizations by rail, quick firing artillery, and a focus on blitz attacks would make war short and decisive. Those ideas were proven wrong at the beginning of the First World War. Countries went in already celebrating the war, thinking that it would be quick and painless. But the 4 years of trench warfare on the Western Front proved them wrong. Then, in the 1930s, it was believed that the aerial bombardment of cities would prove devastating enough to prompt almost immediate surrender. But England's refusal to give in after years of bombardment from the Luftwaffe once again proved them wrong. And when America demonstrated in the First Gulf War what a combination of its precision-guided munitions, surveillance, space-based communication, and stealth technology could achieve, many people assumed that in the future, the West would always be able to rely on swift, painless victories. But after the terrorist attacks on 9/11 and a decades-long conflict in the Middle East, the changing landscape of war proved once again difficult to predict. As a result, the predictions we'll lay forward will be limited to the next 20 years or so, and will focus on several long-term trends in warfare that can be identified with greater confidence. In the past half century, wars between states have become exceedingly rare, and those between great powers and their allies almost non-existent, mainly because of the mutually destructive power of nuclear weapons, international legal constraints, the connectedness of global economies, and the declining appetite for violence among relatively prosperous societies. On the other hand, intrastate or civil wars have been relatively numerous, especially in fragile or failing states, and have usually proved long-lasting. Climate change, population growth, and sectarian or ethnic extremism are likely to ensure that these kinds of smaller, more localized wars continue. And increasingly, they'll be fought in urban environments, if only because by 2040, two-thirds of the world's population will be living in cities. Intense urban warfare, as demonstrated by the recent battles for Aleppo and Mosul in the fight against ISIS, has proven to be a slow grind, fought in close quarters, and sometimes literally street by street. The rise of urban conflicts will also limit the use of traditional weapons of war, like tanks, artillery, and bombers, and will push countries to develop ever more precise weapons, like drones capable of precisely eliminating targets in populated city centers. And these conflicts will continue to present difficult problems with avoiding civilian casualties. Another reason conflicts won't be fought on traditional battlegrounds is the rise of near instantaneous weapon systems. In the past, a jet flying over enemy territory mainly had to worry about being targeted by rockets or rapid-fire guns. These all took time to reach the jet. But now, the development of laser weapons offers the possibility to instantly and precisely hit a target with weapons that move at the speed of light. And the rise in strength of individual weapon systems, like railguns and more powerful bombs, present the possibility of centralized expensive weapon systems, like aircraft carriers, being taken out by single shots and causing devastating losses. This fear has existed ever since the Cold War, when countries realized military air bases would be the targets of first strikes in an effort to keep a nation's air force from taking off the ground. This has, and will continue to incentivize governments to create distributed weapon systems. A prime example is a country like Germany, who maintains highway strips, paved ground alongside highways that could act as small air bases across the country in times of crisis. This would allow the nation's air force to continue operating, even if centralized military airports were destroyed. Today, the US government operates hundreds of forward operating bases around the world, some no more than landing strips cut out from the jungle. And China has built up atolls for military bases spread throughout the South Pacific. With these, powerful countries try to spread their weapons capabilities across wider areas, increasing their utility and protecting them with distance. Another trend we'll see, instead of all-out warfare, is strategic destabilization, as countries like Russia attempt to operate in the gray zone, taking calculated risks as to the extent of cyber warfare they can dole out on their adversaries without risking escalation. And Russia isn't the only one turning to cyber warfare. In 2005, when the US wanted to disable Iranian nuclear centrifuges at the Natanz facility, they didn't launch aerial strikes and risk an all-out war. Instead, they enlisted the help of the NSA and Mossad to take down the plants via cyber warfare. And cyber warfare, unlike more traditional forms of warfare, offers the possibility of attacking an enemy facility without them ever learning who was behind the attack. While it may seem that asymmetries of power will increase as specific nations like the US and China pour money into their military R&D divisions, the rise of third world countries out of poverty is likely to increase the so-called number of players in the game. As these countries become wealthier, they'll develop their own military forces. And while these forces will still pale in comparison to those of first world countries, they'll allow their nations to exert more influence in their immediate international community. This will push out wealthier countries that have traditionally tried dominating the international politics of countries in Central and South America, Africa, and the South Pacific. Even though full-scale interstate warfare between great powers remains unlikely, there is still room for less severe forms of military competition. In particular, both Russia and China now seem unwilling to bow to international pressures. Russia by annexing Crimea and destabilizing Ukraine, and China by building militarized artificial islands and exerting force in disputes with regional neighbors. In the 21st century, both China and Russia have invested in a wide range of capabilities to counter America's presence in their respective regions. In military terms, these tools are what are known as anti-access aerial denial, or A2AD systems. They include a whole host of defensive military technologies, like advanced cruise missiles and mines. Their goal isn't to go to war with the US, but by beefing up defensive fortifications, they want to make an American intervention more risky and more costly. Another issue that has loomed large over international conflicts for decades are nuclear weapons and the threat of mutually assured destruction. But this has offered a tantalizing possibility. If a country could neutralize enemy ballistic missiles, they would no longer have to fear a nuclear attack and could act however they wanted, largely unchecked. This need to neutralize nuclear threats has pushed nations to develop means of disabling them. Russia and China now fear that technologies currently in development could allow the US to threaten their nuclear arsenals without resorting to a nuclear first strike. America has been working on a concept known as conventional prompt global strike for over a decade. The idea is to deliver a conventional warhead at hypersonic speeds, at up to 5 times the speed of sound, through even the most densely defended airspace. Possible targets include enemy communication satellites, command centers for those A2AD systems, nuclear facilities, and even incoming ICBMs. These missiles, mixed with good old cyber warfare, could potentially protect a nation from enemy nuclear threats. And the last major trend is that the domain of conflicts will only increase. 9,000 years ago, warfare was limited to land. Then it exploded into naval conflicts. And in the 20th century, we saw armed conflicts take to the skies, aboard planes, missiles, and eventually ICBMs. Going into the future, as the domains of human existence expand, so too will the domains of potential conflict. Everything from deep oceans to the Arctic to outer space are now perceived as gateways to economic and strategic advantage, and so nations will vie to maintain their dominance in them. But whatever the future holds, hopefully we'll all be alive to see it. Don't forget to subscribe with notifications on so you never miss an upload. And if you made it this far, consider watching this video here. Have a great day, and remember, there's always more to learn.